Hey guys, it's Jeff Lafferty. It's Artcast 514. It's day 97 of my 100 days of making comics. Almost done with that 100 days. My comic is The Berserkonaut. It's in demand on Indiegogo. You can read a good chunk of it over at berserkonaut.com. Let's get going. Another one of these late night videos. So just trying to get it done and out. I don't know if you guys caught the Artcasters live show on Scott Circlin's channel last night, but they had me come on, and yeah, it was a great show. It was really fun talking to those guys, Joshua Kimball and Scott Circlin. Haven't been on the show for a long time, so it was just really fun catching up. I thought we had like a great talk about indie comics, so I'll link it in the show notes if you guys haven't had a chance to go listen to it, because if you like to draw at night and listen to guys talk about comics and get inspired, I think that's a show to listen to. So I've had like many requests now to talk about the stuff that was going on with Alterna a few days ago. I think it's sort of past now. I haven't been on Twitter for the last couple days, so I don't know. It could still be going on. If you don't know what's going on, Alterna was retweeting people that bought their books and posted pictures of them with their Alterna comic. And so some of those guys turned out to be Comicsgate affiliated type people, you know, people that support Comicsgate. And then, somebody in the industry noticed that and went and asked Peter Simeti, who is the publisher of Alterna, what's up? What are you, Comicsgate? What's your deal? And he was real polite and pretty much just said, hey, I'm just selling comics. I just publish my comics. He's not somebody that goes in for the drama. And of course they jumped on the bandwagon of like, well, that answer means that you're obviously for them, because unless you're against them, you're not with us, kind of a thing. And so then after that, I think Peter, he put this thing out online, which was sort of like a Twitter code of conduct. Where he just kind of said, hey, anybody that works for Alterna, don't get into a pissing match with some 14-year-old kid on Twitter. Said some more stuff than that. It talked about block bots and things like that. But it just pretty much, hey, act like a civil human being so that you don't alienate the fans and add to like what's happening with, Marvel Comics, right? I don't think that's unreasonable. But then, of course, like Mark Waid, industry giant, has to come along and jump on Alterna, and start denouncing it. I guess he wants to have his right to just, flip out on Twitter anytime he wants and block people in mass and all that kind of thing. So, of course he mentions Alterna, and then, while it happened, Mark Waid's fans come over and they start fucking with Alterna, which sucks, because Alterna is like a tiny little company. Mark Waid is like an established comics pro. He's not going to have any problems paying his rent and staying in comics and all that kind of stuff. But if somebody starts, turning the tide against Alterna, Alterna could go away like this year, because I'm sure they're not making a ton of money. So that was a crappy thing to do. And then I guess one of his creator teams that worked on an Alterna book decided to make a stand against Alterna and say that they can't work with a company that supports Comicsgate. So they're leaving, and we're going to make a big public announcement and, very publicly, show how great we are, how virtuous we are, and walk away from Alterna, because they're such a horrible company. And I just think like everything that's going on is just total crap. And as I said, I've had a lot of people just kind of like talking to me on Facebook and stuff and saying like, Jeff, make a video. You have influence, make a video, because it's going to make more people that have influence make videos. But it made me think about comics back in the day, like I always do. I always have some story about comics back in the day, right? And I started thinking about the Comic Book Legal Defense Fund. Let me look up the page real quick, see if it's still around. So it looks like it is actually still here. That's interesting, because back in the 90s, it was needed, because what was happening in the 90s was you had a lot of indie books, you had a lot of black and white books. And a lot of these indie creators, comics spelled with C-O-M-I-X on the end, you know what I mean? People like Zap Comics and just all sorts of different crazy creators would put out books that were so divisive. They were so extreme, I guess you could say. Some of them had, you know, extreme political views. Some of them bashed on religion. Some of them were obscene or considered obscene in some states, you know. Tons of super volatile type stuff was in these books. And not every comic shop carried them, but a lot of comic shops did, you know. The weirder comic shops carried them. The cooler comic shops carried stuff like that. And so every now and then, you know, like what would happen is there'd be a comic shop in some state. And the government or whoever decided that, you know, man, these comics are just ridiculous. We can't have, you know, kids buying these comics. And they would actually go in and arrest the comic shop owner, throw him in jail. And then, you know, of course, he couldn't get out, couldn't pay his legal bills, and he'd end up losing the shop and it'd have to close down, you know. And that kind of stuff was actually happening. And also creators were getting arrested. So the Comic Book Legal Defense Fund came into existence and was all funded through donations in the beginning. They put out books that, you know, were like charity raising books for the Comic Book Legal Defense Fund. And the whole point of it was to show up when this stuff was going down, pay legal fees, get lawyers to fight this kind of BS, and to protect, you know, free speech. That's what it was all about. And let me look in the site. Let me see if I can find some of the cases and just kind of... Oh, here we go. Case files. Let's see what they got. Now, here's one I remember. I remember this guy, Mike Diana. Mike Diana versus Florida is what the case is called. Mike Diana was this kid, really, who put out this comic. Let me see if I can find it. It's called Boiled Angel. And this comic was horrible. This comic was terrible. I don't know if it was even a real comic. I think it was more like a Kinko's kind of job. You know, went to a copy store and just stapled together some pages and then self-distributed. But it might have went through Diamond. I'm not sure. But, you know, it was like a black and white book. I remember kind of seeing some of the art in maybe like the Comics Journal or something. You know, one of these offbeat publications. And if I remember right, it had... stuff about like rape in it. It had some cannibalism. It had extreme violence. Let's see what they say. Well, they're saying child abuse was actually in it. Date rape was in it. Religious corruption. And anyway, he got freaking arrested. The cops showed up and took his books, put them in evidence, threw him in jail. And I believe they were gonna like, you know, prosecute him on obscenity charges. And so, anyway, the Comic Book Legal Defense Fund showed up and defended this guy, you know, this horrible human being, according to some people. And he probably was pretty weird and bizarre. And I'm sure I wouldn't have dug his book. And, you know, he didn't have any friends in the industry. He didn't hang out with Todd McFarlane and Rob Liefeld or anything like that, you know. He was just some nobody, and really until he got his butt thrown in jail, nobody paid any attention to him. Let's see another one. Okay, here's another one. Friendly Franks versus Illinois. Now, Friendly Franks was a comic shop. I think the cops came in and arrested the owner of the comic shop, if I remember right. Do they actually say why in this article here? Oh, yeah, here we go. Seized 7 titles. So they came in, they raided the store, seized 7 titles, including Omaha the Cat Dancer, Weirdo, Heavy Metal. They got busted for Heavy Metal. Can you believe that? I mean, that's pretty much on every newsstand anywhere. This was in 1986, yeah. That's definitely a time you could have bought Heavy Metal at a grocery store. The store manager, Michael Correa, was arrested and dragged off in handcuffs. That's freaking unbelievable. Shortly after the original raid, police added Electra Assassin. Oh my God. I mean, Electra Assassin is like a great book by Frank Miller. Incredible book. You know, it's the kind of book that should be in every bookstore. Love and Rockets, which is another great book by the Hernandez brothers. Let's see. Mystery, Bodicy, and ElfQuest. Are you kidding me? Does ElfQuest even have like a boob in it? Like, what state? Oh yeah, Illinois. I mean... What the hell? Anyway, Yeah, this was the horrible trash that they were protecting children from in Illinois. And I was just wondering if he actually got convicted. Okay, so anyway, and so they tried to get him on obscenity, and the judge declared that the comics seized were bizarre, but they did not constitute obscenity, and he overturned Korea's guilty verdict. So anyway, my point, now I'm kind of coming back around to what the point is, so hang with me for a few more minutes. So the Comic Book Legal Defense Fund would show up and defend these guys, you know, defend these guys that were up on obscenity charges, you know, these guys that were looked at like the bad guys of comics in a way. Like I said, they didn't have friends. They might not be popular. And the Comic Book Legal Defense Fund would still show up and defend them. And it's like, why? Why would they do that? They would do it because of free speech. Because whether you wanted to hear what they had to say or not, free speech is more important than that. You know, whether they're your friend or your enemy, like I said, free speech is more important than that. And if these guys who were throwing these creators and comic book shop owners in jail, these book burning thugs, these losers, could come along and throw these guys in jail, well, if they could get away with that, then they could come along and they could throw your favorite creator in jail, or worse, they could come along and throw you in jail for the same bullshit. You know, that's why it's important to stand up for free speech for everyone and not let your own political preferences and your own ideology get in the way of that. And so when, you know, you're joining the club on Twitter going against Alterna and you're beating down a indie publisher, you need to stop and think. You need to stop and think for a second, because if this was back in the day and this was the 90s and the Comic Book Legal Defense Fund showed up, they wouldn't be on your side. You know what I mean? They'd be on Alterna's side. This is very similar to what's going on with Comics Gate and everybody standing up against them and trashing them. Because over and over and over, these indie comics. And I know people don't like when I say this, but these indie comics creators are getting caught up in the meat grinder that's going after Comics Gate. Alterna is like an indie comics creator, and what's happening to him right now? You got people coming out against him. You got like Mark Waid, Marvel Big Shot, Marvel Big Mouth, whatever you want to say about him. He might as well be kicking the kid over in the wheelchair because, you know, Marvel is the biggest company there is, and Alterna is maybe the smallest company there is. And it's just not right. And I think everybody needs to like stop and think about that, because it's important. Because like as I said, you might be on the side of the bigger mob today, but what happens when that mob turns around tomorrow and they're coming back in your direction and they're trying to squash you? So, okay, that's it. Mailing list. If you're not getting notifications, I'll send them to you. What else? InDiegogo for the Berserkonaut and Patreon to support the channel. I'll see you guys tomorrow.